and welcome to JSTV, a ministry of Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel in beautiful Yucca Valley, California. We'd like to thank you for joining us today for our verse-by-verse study through the Bible with Assistant Pastor B.J. Heather. We would also like to encourage you to grab your Bible, maybe a cup of coffee, and join us for the service already underway.
Amen. All right, so let's go ahead and turn on the lights. All right, so I hope everyone had an awesome holiday break. Did everyone have a great break? Was it refreshing, and are you ready to be back? Yes. Amen, absolutely. Well, mine was awesome. I gotta say, the end of 2016, actually all of 2016 was the craziest year of my life. I could say that maybe top two, as opposed to, you know, actually probably when my dad died, that was a crazy year, but this year was pretty crazy, and it ended absolutely nuts, but I had a great, great Christmas, and it was, you know, my wife is pregnant. She's due this week. She's due on Wednesday, actually, so if you guys have ever prayed, pray nonstop, all right, for my wife, and so Wednesday, she's due. Thursday, if she doesn't have the baby by Wednesday, they're going to induce, and then we will be having a little baby on Friday, and actually, that's my birthday. So little Vera will be born maybe on my birthday, which I think is pretty great. Someone's like, well, what do you think about you guys sharing birthdays? I think it's fantastic. You get them both out at once, and it's awesome. Then everyone's not focused on how old you're getting, but how adorable your daughter is. How old's BJ again? I mean, his daughter's, she's 10 now, and don't worry about it, you know? So, but I'm excited. It was the best ending to any year. I was moving out of one home in October. I ended up selling a home at the end of November that I actually sold it. And then moving out of one home into another home, closing on two houses while my wife's pregnant and moving. And it was chaos, but amazing. And God was there through the whole thing. He is so faithful. No matter what you're going through, He has a plan for your life. And then we get to Christmas time, and I was a part of the Christmas morning service, which was something I've never done before, and it was absolutely amazing. Gerald and I co-did it, and we had all the kids up front and just told the Christmas story, and that was an amazing blessing. And then we went over to the house and Gerald's house and ate delicious food, and then we pulled out the board games, okay? And this isn't something my family usually does, okay? Usually it's talking and hanging out, but we brought out board games. And we brought out Apples to Apples. Have you guys played Apples to Apples? Apparently I'm pro at it because I won. I'm just throwing that out there. Audrey got second. The Heathers are the best. Anyways, woo! Woo! Anyways, so that was great. And then we pulled out a game called Balderdash. Anyone know anything about Balderdash? All right, well, basically, there's a definition, there's a word, and you have to write out the definition, and then the real word is in there. And we found out I always remember when I was young, my dad would get so upset at my mom at playing this game, because they played it for years and years and years, and now I'm playing it, but I always knew my dad would be like, Merrily, like in the middle of the game, and I never understood why until I saw Gerald and my mom's relationship. Basically, whenever it got to Gerald's, my mom would just bust out laughing. Bust out laughing. I think it's because she knows Gerald and how he thinks. And so before she had even said what the definition was, and you're not supposed to know who wrote the definition, she would die laughing. And so we're like, well, that's Gerald's. Okay, so the next four. And he's like, Merrily. He never actually left the start line. Everyone else finished, and he never left the start line. And finally, he's like, I'm just not playing anymore. I'm just not playing anymore. I'm done. So that was good. And my New Year's and New Year's Eve and all that was extremely uneventful, which I will go into. But baby is on the way. Birthday is coming. So I'm still very much in the holiday season. Ain't no one bringing me down. So before we left for Christmas, we were looking at 2 Corinthians. I'm still doing that joke. It's still good. All right, so I was in 2 Corinthians. So if you want to turn there, go ahead and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And we were looking at Paul, right? We were looking at Paul and what he was talking about. And he was being very transparent on his life and even his life in ministry, right? Chapter 4, verses 8 through 12 say this. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. Always caring about in the body of the dying of the Lord, Jesus, that life of Jesus may also be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death is working in us, but life in you. Listen, while Paul would serve in ministry, I mean, and he through his whole ministry, it was riddled with pain and suffering, with things that he was doing for the Lord. It was literally the things that he would go through. We're going to talk about some of them tonight, but there was a lot of pain and a lot of things that happened. But listen, these trials that would ruin some. If anyone else was faced with a lot of the stuff that Paul did without a relationship with the Lord, it would ruin them. But listen, the trials that ruin some only show the power and strength of Christ in our lives as we go through them to the world. People look at us as believers, and they should be looking at you going, how are they doing it? Because listen, life is going to be rough at times. You're going to have things happen to you that you do not understand. You're going to have attacks that come at you that you are going to feel are oh man, these are so strong. But listen, as you rely on the Lord, you become evident of God's power. John 16, 33 says this, as Jesus was speaking, he says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation. Okay, Jesus is like, in me, you may have peace. In the world, you're gonna have tribulation, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. That's what we have in Jesus. And listen, even in your worst trial, even in your biggest problem, God is working all things, not some things, not only the things you view as good, but all things together for our good, amen? And so we're going to recap some more of the message that we went through before we left here. But let's go ahead and look at the new scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 12 through chapter 5, verse 4. So let's look here. It says here in verse 12, so then death is working in us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke, we also believe and therefore speak. Knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace having spread through the many may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked, for we are who are in this tent grown, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we love you. Lord, we thank you so much for this opportunity to be able to meet together as the church, Lord, and worship your name, Lord, to learn what you have for us, and Lord, to study your word. Lord, I pray as we gather here that this would just be a beautiful thing for you. Lord, I pray that every single one of us, Lord God, would have the same focus, Lord, to give you the glory, to give you our time, to give you our efforts, Lord God, this week and the rest of the month, Lord, in this 2017. Lord, that our focus would be on loving people, Lord God, showing people what you've done for us, Lord God, and having your name be made famous. Lord Jesus, I just pray right now that you would fall upon this room, Lord Jesus, and that you would break any chains, Lord God, you would break any strongholds that are oppressing anyone, and this would just be a wonderful time of your Holy Spirit ministering to your people in a way that we have never seen before. Lord, I pray that you would work outside of the box that we so often put you in, and Lord, that you would do an amazing work in our hearts tonight. Lord, give us that excitement again when we were first saved. Give us that expectation, Lord, that you are going to do something new and fresh, Lord. Let us never become stale. So, Lord, I pray that your word tonight would just be beautiful in our hearts. Lord, that you would convict, and Lord, you would comfort, and Lord, that you would encourage in a way that only you can. And Lord, it would all be your spirit speaking to spirit. And so, Lord, with that, Lord, we pray if there's anything in here that shouldn't be in here, Lord God, if there's anything trying to keep this message from going out, Lord, we pray that it would leave in Jesus' name, and this would be an awesome time of your church tearing down strongholds. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's look at verses 13 through 15. It says here, "And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed, and therefore I spoke. We also believe, and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God." Now, it's been a few weeks ago, but we talked about how as Christians, we have a treasure that we get to carry, right? We are broken vessels oftentimes, but the Lord is what is holding us together. And what we are carrying is the treasure, right? It's like a bottle of perfume, right? Or a bottle of cologne. You're not paying $80, even though sometimes the bottles are pretty great, right? They're starting to make them kind of neat, but you're not paying $80 just for the bottle. You're paying for what's inside of it. That is what we have in Jesus when we give our hearts to the Lord. Listen, the good that's in us is not this, it's not who we are, it's who Jesus is, and it's what's on display to the world. And that's when people start to look at us, and we have this treasure that we carry, this salvation message that we get to bring to the world. We get to bring this life-changing power of the gospel to the world. And that is the good that's inside of us. And as we do this, the Lord begins to strengthen the vessel, right? He begins to have the vessel do things that the vessel thought it could never do. He begins to fix the cracks and all the hurt that's inside of you, and he begins to restore you and who you are. Listen, his power is on display because people knew the broken earthly vessel that you were before you came to the Lord. People knew who you were, and now there's a change. And so he begins to empower you. He begins to fix you and mend you and make you stronger. And so now we're gonna see Paul here as he's talking, and he begins to quote here. It's kind of weird. He just kind of throws it in there. But in verse 13, you'll see, he says, "And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and therefore speak." What he is quoting from in these times where he just got done talking about being, in verses 8 through 12, like I said, hard-pressed but not crushed, perplexed but not in despair. This is what he says. He says that he believes and therefore he spoke. And he's quoting from Psalms 116, and it's a part from 8 through 14, but I'm going to read it to you real fast. This is what he's quoting from. It says, "For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. And I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living." And this is the part that he took from in verse 10. It says, "I believed and therefore I spoke. I am greatly afflicted. I said in my haste, all men are liars. What shall I render to the Lord for all of his benefits towards me? I will take up the cup of salvation and I will call upon the name of the Lord and I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all of his people." Listen, Paul was able to do these things. Paul was able to move forward because he believed in the words that he was saying. Everything that Paul did and all the purpose that he had and all the suffering that he was to go through, he was able to do it because there was not a doubt of the thing that he was saying was true. He knew the power that was in the name of Jesus. He knew what God had done to save him. He knew how wicked he was before he turned to the Lord. And in these times that it feels like you're going to be absolutely crushed, he begins to preach words that he had read in Psalms, like I said, 116. And this is why it is so important to know what God's word says. You wonder why we have this hokey kind of saying that we say over and over again to where it's almost like a joke, like read your Bible and pray every day. And we say it, but you can't let it lose its meaning. There's a reason you got to know what God's word says. It's because your trials, your tribulations, the crushing, the being, you know, all these situations that are coming to get you, you need to be able to speak scripture into your life. You need to be able to speak God's truth into your life. And you know what? Not only that, but not just be able to speak it, but be able to apply it to who you are as believers. Because let me tell you, as you begin to do that, you're like Paul. It's in the difference of being hard-pressed but not crushed, right? Having this, being able to speak God's truth into your life, it's the difference of being hard-pressed and not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed. Paul, like every single one of us as believers, guys, Paul, like every single one of us, had an opportunity to speak negativity into his life. And we do it all the time. But he had the chance to speak things like defeat and despair into his life in situations that seemed impossible. As he walks into a situation and it didn't turn out the way that he thought it was going to, he had the chance to go, oh, this is so hard. How am I ever going to be able to do this? This is too big for me. I don't know. Instead, he chooses to say that he's been through all these things and he says this, I believed and therefore I spoke. He relies on God's word and God's truth and God's promises in that time. Because listen, what you say about your situation will oftentimes become the truth about your situation. If you want to be negative about your life and that there's no hope in your life and you can't just carry on, and how could this all happen? There's people like that in this room. There's people like that in this church that will come forward every single time and there's just no hope and I can't carry on and the life is, you're like, this is like the fifth or sixth year that this is continuing on. Stop talking about your life that way. Because God is in control of your crazy storm right now, and when you give it over to him, he's going to start teaching you about what he's doing in your life. Start speaking God's truth and God's scripture into your life. Because in my own life, church, I have done this both ways. I've been to many times where I've spoken disparity and confusion into my life. Do these lights keep going on and off and on and off? Because it is driving me nuts. I'm sorry. I'm like, am I about ready to pass out? What's happening here? The lights keep going off. But in my life, I've had the opportunity. They're getting brighter. One or the other, I'm good either way. But in my life, I've had the opportunity to speak disparity and confusion into my life, and what good does it do me? You know, oh, Audrey, oh, we just, oh, this is so hard, and how could they say such mean things? How could people do this? And instead of saying, you know what, God's got it, God's in control, who could come against us? We have the Lord. He's teaching us something. And listen, I have also had times where I've relied on God's power and God's calling, and I've never once been like, man, I wish I would have spoken a little bit more despair into that situation, right? I've never once been like that. I've always, at the end of it, been like, man, God is so good. I cannot believe I freaked out about that thing 2 weeks ago. Paul knew this truth. Paul knew this thing that he was saying. He said that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. This truth that he just spoke is the same truth that all of us have. That he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus. This same truth that he held on to, that he carried with him, is the same one that we have in our life. And let me tell you, that truth shines greater than any circumstance that you're going through right now in your life. You know, these themes, and we talk about this often, but keeping the focus of your life on what God has for you. We talk about this a lot, but the focus of Paul, he has it in verse 15. What does he say? He says, for all things are for your sakes, that grace having spread through the many may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. This life and who you are and all, everything that God has made you, it's about this. It's about others. Okay? Here he says, for all things are for your sakes. It's about others. The reason you're here is to serve, is to be a servant, is to bless. That's what God has for you. That is how you get fulfillment. And the second thing is everything is done unto the glory of God. So it's about serving others, right? And it's about giving God the glory for it. Not serving others and being some, I am such a humanitarian. I am a wonderful person. I donate this much money. It's about giving God the glory and you disappearing. That's your life. Stop thinking it's just about you because you're just a flash in the pan. God is in control. And verse 16, he says this, therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Oh man, the outward man is perishing. And this word, if you actually look up in the Greek, this word perishing is changing for the worse. Our outward man is changing for the worse. And now I need everyone in here to admit with me, because if we don't admit to this while moving forward, we're gonna have a lot of confused people. But can we all please get on the same level that our outward man is slowly changing for the worse? There's some of you that don't think it is, but I will look at you and tell you that you are changing for the worse. That's not in my notes. Anyways, I know I'm changing for the worst. Oh my gosh, I know I'm changing for the worst. I just recently tried to teach my daughter how to skateboard, okay? I used to be the man at skateboarding. I was always a bigger guy, but I was really good. And so that's the part that like really made me stand out. They're like, oh wow, like how is he doing that? And I'm like, I don't know, but I'm gonna be able to do this for the rest of my life, you know? Not so. With my daughter, and I'm like, I'm just gonna show you a few simple tricks. And she's like, okay. And I didn't wow her at all, I guarantee you. And then I'm pulling her on the skateboard, you know, and she's like this. And then she starts to kind of lose her balance. And I'm like, you gotta stay on it. Don't be scared to fall. If you fall, you fall, you know. And I'm sitting there. And then she does one of these where she kind of goes like this and launches the board into my shin. And that used to happen to me all the time when I was young. And yeah, it stung, but I was like, ah, you need to sit down for 1 second and be like, oh, I'm good. I'm still at home like, honey, do you see the bump? Do you see it? Do you think it's gonna go away? Look at the bump, you know? And I started off the service, you guys, talking about Christmas, right? And what a great time Christmas was. Oh, it was great. I played board games. There's something perishing when I am getting older and playing board games with my mom and dad and sitting here playing board games. But what really gets weird, and I'm definitely perishing, is that New Year's Eve, I said it was uneventful. I can't tell you how uneventful it really was. I got together with a couple people from the church, and we hung out. And then at about 9, me and Audrey are like, yeah, so I think it's about time we go to bed. And then the funny part was they're younger than we are. They're like, yeah, we got to go feed the dogs. Yeah, we'll feed the dogs and we'll see you guys tomorrow. We went to bed at 9:30 on New Year's Eve, okay? Maybe 9:45 at latest. And the worst part is I was completely content on doing so. I thought it was fantastic. I'm like, why would anyone stay up till midnight just to watch a ball drop and then go, it's 2017. I'm like, at that point, I looked at Audrey as we're in bed at 9:45 or whatever, and I'm like, we're so old. We're so old. And then I do a message on my outward man perishing. I'm like, it all makes sense now, okay? But here's the thing. Your outward man is perishing, and some of us are trying to make it look like it's not, but it is. And at the same time, our inward man, as believers, is being renewed day by day. Listen, church, your inward man doesn't have to match your outward man. Your inward man shouldn't match your outward man. through your walk with the Lord, you're going to discover new things every day with the Lord and about his grace and his mercy and his sovereignty and his power in your life as you walk with him through the power of the Holy Spirit. You don't have to worry about this body breaking down. That's what it does. But your inward man, as you walk with him, becomes more and more mature. My favorite term for people that have walked with the Lord for many years are mighty oaks of the faith. People that, if their body's breaking down, they are still just a wellspring of knowledge because their roots go so deep in the Lord that they are stronger than we are, I mean, than I am by any means, because they have walked with the Lord for 50 years, 60 years. And just to see their inward man being young and renewed and fresh, and their outward man, which we're going to talk about later, but it's perishing, it's changing for the worst. And we need to remember this in our life right now, wherever you're at, however old you are, that this is the natural progression, that your outward man's going to perish and your inward man's going to be renewed. But you need to remember this, because right now in your life as you get older, it's going to be easier and easier and easier for you to lose heart and to be discouraged and to walk away from everything that the Lord has for you just because it's harder. And you can't do that. On those times, I mean, listen, Paul in his life had many times where he could have just said, well, it needs to go to someone else. I'm giving it over. This is my last letter. I'm never writing you again. Because it's easy to give up. But in those times, you cannot rely on your outward man. You cannot rely on being tired. You cannot rely on your limitations. But you must rely on the power of the Holy Spirit working through your inward man. Paul wouldn't listen to things like feelings and emotions. We can't listen to things like feelings and emotions. And this is one of my favorite things to say, because your emotions and your feelings are liars. They're liars limiting you to the power that the Lord has for you. Instead, in those times that he felt like he was destroyed, he would look at what the Lord was doing inside of him and rely on that for his strength. Verses 17 through 18 says this: for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I love that he says the words, our light affliction. It's but for a moment. Isn't this the way it is? Our light affliction is but for a moment. But does it ever feel that way when you're going through it? Does it ever feel like, oh, this trial or problem, it's gonna be over just real quick? You're like, this is never going to end, you know? This problem is too hard, you know? And instead of going, you know what, our light affliction, which is but for a moment, remind yourself that. Next time you're going through a hard time, our light affliction, which is for a moment. You're like, but here's the problem. It's not a light affliction. What I'm going through is far from a light affliction, right? Well, Paul knew a little bit about that, because he's calling light affliction being beaten. He's calling a light affliction being almost stoned to death. He's calling a light affliction being shipwrecked and almost drowning. That's his light affliction. What is your light affliction? What is my light affliction? Because I'm telling you, it is just for a moment. He says that this light affliction that he is going through is doing something exceedingly great in him. It's working in him exceedingly, doing major things in his life. These little problems, these things that are fleeting, are growing him up, that are working in his inward man, that are working things together. Some of the craziest times of my life, you guys. In a few days after I'm done with it, at that time, I felt like it was never going to end. In my life, I've had trials where I literally thought that this is going to follow me the rest of my life. this is never going to get better. And if I speak those things into my life, what happens? Those problems never go away. When I go to places, I think that this is going to happen. When I speak to someone, I think this is going to happen. Instead of realizing that this is a light affliction and it's but for a moment and it will end. And in comparison to God's glory and how good our God is, it really is nothing. And then once you're through with it, isn't this the truth? You can see exactly how God grew you. In my life, every single time, I can see exactly what God did in my life through that problem. I am more patient. I am more understanding. I'm different with my words. I mean, there's a lesson to be taught in every single trial. That trial you're going through, I don't know what it is for you. I've talked to some of you, so I know some of the trials, but whatever trial that is right now, whatever thing that you are struggling with, you're going to get through it. You're going to get through it by the power of the Holy Spirit. But please don't sit here and talk like you're not. Don't listen to the enemy and don't listen to the flesh that's broken and falling apart. Instead, rely on the power of the Holy Spirit, because it is nothing. The problem you're going through right now is nothing compared to the plan that God has for your life. It is nothing. It is nothing. Your momentary hard times is nothing to an eternity of worshiping Jesus. Your momentary hard time, which is coming to an end, is nothing to an eternity of worshiping the Savior, Jesus Christ. It is nothing to the growth that you're going to receive through these hard times. It is nothing to the reminder of Christ's suffering. Every time you suffer, remember how much Christ suffered for you. Lord, man, this suffering, it's really hard, but compared to what you've done for me, it is nothing. Remind yourself that this momentary hard time is nothing but a proof of your faith to others. That what you're saying and speaking with mouth service is becoming living and real right in front of them. And not just that, but that you're going to have the opportunity to share with them in those hard times. And this is why our eyes and focus cannot be on this life, because our problems are hard. Our problems that we go through, we feel like we're never going to be able to go through. But it needs to be on these things. So in hard times, it needs to be on these things, you guys. The glory that God is going to get. All right? So as you're going through hard times, go, Lord, where can I give you glory? Is it in having trust publicly in the situation? Two, ask yourself how God is going to use you with others. And, whoa, hey. And also, keeping that eternal perspective, guys. We got to keep that eternal perspective and viewing your troubles as opportunities to further the kingdom. Amen? And to further your personal growth. Because if you don't, it's just going to be about you being, I'm abandoned and I'm destroyed and all these other things. So look at chapter 5, verse 1. It says, for we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. So we know that this earthly body, that this tent, will someday go away. I talked about it a little bit. I talked about my New Year's. I talked about, it's the outward man is perishing. But we, all of us, these bodies we're in right now, these tents, that, I love that he calls them tents, because what are tents? Tents are absolutely temporary. No matter how well they're assembled, no matter how well they're built, no matter what you do to reinforce them, they are still temporary and someday will be destroyed. And listen, our bodies are the same exact way. Now, there's things you can do to prolong your life. There's things you can do. God holds your life, but there's things you can do, exercise and these other things that will further your life. But at the same time, we're all going to end up in the same spot, right? Every single one of us, these bodies are breaking away. These bodies are going away. And Paul says, here's the good news. If something happens, which it will, that's not what I want you guys to go home with tonight. Something's going to happen and I'm going to die. Like, that's what I got out of this message. But Paul says if something happens to our tent, it's going to break down like it's supposed to, that we have a building from God, a house made with hands eternal in the heavens. Because he's speaking to a culture, Paul is speaking to them, and we know by 1 Corinthians that they didn't believe in a physical resurrection. They didn't believe that there was going to, they only believed the soul was the only thing that was going to be resurrected, and they didn't believe in a physical resurrection. And so he's going to be able to speak to them. 1 Corinthians 15, if you guys want to turn there with me real fast. It's only a few pages back, but 1 Corinthians 15, verses 40 through 48. This is what he had to say about our new bodies. And so he's trying to tell them about it as he's kind of driving it home again. It says in chapter 15, verses 40 to 48, it says, there are also celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies, but the glory of the celestial one and the glory of the terrestrial one is another. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. For one star differs from another star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, and it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, and it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, but it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body, and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, hold on, give me a second, guys. I'm going to try to fix this here. There we go. And so it's written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural. And afterward, the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven. And as was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. Right? He begins to tell us what it looks like. In Philippians 3, 18 through 21, he says this, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. And then listen what he says here. For our citizenship, it is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body, and it will be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. Therefore, my beloved and longed for brethren, my joy and crown, stand fast in the Lord, beloved. He's speaking about what's going to happen to our physical bodies here. Verses 2 through 4, and what we're ending on, says this about having this new body. He says, for in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up in life. This is the most beautiful thing for believers. This is the most beautiful thing. And this is also dealing with the same thing that scares some people the most. Death, right? What happens when we die? What happens, the resurrection? How does this all work? For the world, death is the scariest thing that can happen. But for us, he's almost speaking with a groaning that he wants to go, that he wants to be further clothed, that he knows that if something happened to this body, that it would be not the end. Because our habitation, he says, which is from heaven. In 1 Corinthians 15, 54 through 55, he says this, so when the corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? And O Hades, where is your victory? Today, with the idea of this body being a tent, let me ask you a question. With the idea that you are breaking down, every day you're a little bit closer to dying. I know that sounds really negative, but it shouldn't be. Because every day that you are closer to dying is every day that you are completely transformed. Okay? So don't let this be discouraging, but with the idea of your body being a tent and it breaking down and it being very real and it shouldn't be in the very back of your mind, are you being heavenly minded today? Is your focus and your heart godly? Is it heavenly? Is your heart on what God has for you and being clothed in what the Lord has for you? Or is it focusing on remodeling this tent? And when I say remodeling this tent, sure, I'm talking about physically remodeling this tent. I'm talking about the amount of time, money, and effort that some people do to plastic surgery themselves into looking like something that's not decomposing, something that's not breaking down, but we are all breaking down. But not even talking about the physical act of making this tent look like it's our eternal tent or how we're always going to look, but also too with just our focus on our life. Are we focusing on building up this tent here? Are we focused on all the stuff that we can consume, all the things that we can have? Are we focused, or are we focused on what we're doing for the Lord? The only thing that's going to last forever is what we do for the Lord. Everything else is perishing. And let me tell you, for me, my birthday is this Friday, okay? I shared that at the beginning. And every year, I can truly say that every year, I'm more excited to go home to be with Jesus. Not that it's like, oh, I hate this life or I can't. It's just, I'm excited. I realize that the Lord could come right now as we're all here, or it could be when I pass away. But every year, I'm more excited for what the Lord has for me in the year that I'm serving him, but also too, if something happened, that I am secure in the Lord. And that's a little bit more of your inward man being renewed. That you don't have to fear. You don't have to fear anything. And that is refreshing. And that is renewing, that you can wake up every single day of your life and not worry about it. You just focus on what the Lord has for you. And listen, I understand that some of you in here are groaning more than others for your new body, right? Some of you have walls caving in and leaky roofs and broken pipes, right? Maybe your foundation is already cracked, right? Your tent is on its way to perishing, but saints, let me remind you of something, that this body here is not your eternal body, okay? And there's a time coming that you're not gonna have to worry about those things. Your eternal body, there'll be no sickness. There'll be no cancer. There'll be no mourning. There'll be no regrets. There'll be no shame, and there'll be no hurt. And if you want to see an example of a resurrected body, look no further than Jesus when he was resurrected. He wasn't held by the limitations of the physical body. He had a different body. He was still recognizable, right? They knew he was Jesus, but he wasn't held back from everything that this body holds us back from. And listen, when you realize more and more how beautiful that is, you will groan all the more. I love what Gerald says. Every single time that he sees something happening, he always says, you know, listen, if I ever get to that point, just let me go. I want to go home to be with the Lord someday. And so I'm not going to try to prolong things and make things happen. And I'm ready for the Lord whenever he wants me. And that's where every single one of us needs to be. And if you can get to that point in your life where whenever it happens, you're going to have a much more joyful life. Not focus on, oh, what happened when I die, right? Because listen, your future is certain. Jesus came that you may have life more abundantly. Jesus came that you may have eternal life. And listen, I've been with many as their outward man finally perished. I've been with many as their tent finally broke. And for those of them that, and it's so weird when I talk about it, it's just a flood of people that I've seen. You know, that's why I get so emotional whenever I talk about it. It's not just, you know, I always bring up my dad, but it's not just my dad. I mean, there's been so many in the ministry here that I've been at that I've been right by their bed as their tent broke. But I'll tell you, their outward man did not match their inward man. There was no doubt on where they were headed. There was no doubt that their broken, sick body was going to be the thing that they were going to inherit for the rest of their life. They wanted to be clothed more with their heavenly body. And it's an amazing thing to see. Because there's a maturity that happens in your heart every year of your life. You know, 2017 hopefully will be the year that you grew more with the Lord than you've ever grown before. And then 2018 will be hopefully the year that you grew more with the Lord than you've ever grown before. And 2019, you guys get what I'm saying? I don't have to, how many more years are you going to go? 2019 will be more than, you know, that's the hope. That your inward man is renewed, that your inward man is growing. And as we're leaving this place, and as we have the worship team come back up and kind of dim the lights and everything, as we leave this place, do you realize how good God is to you? Do you realize that he has done everything so that your broken body isn't the thing that you need to focus on, even though it's perishing? Is your focus on not losing heart? Is your focus on renewing the inward man? Or is your focus on things that are fleeting? In this life, you guys, we need to realize that our life is so temporary. We get a very, very small, I mean, compared to eternity, we get a very, very small amount of time here to serve the Lord, to tell people about Jesus, to be those earthly vessels that are carrying that treasure. We get a very small amount of time. And how much of this amount of life are we using to give God glory? Because I know with this amount of life, many of us forget that that's what it's about. And we spend this amount of time of our life remodeling our own comforts, remodeling our own life. And then we sit and we go, what did I do with my life? You know, I have friends in Idaho that when they were 16 and punk rock and, you know, all these things, it was great for them to be able to not worry about life and just go to shows and do all these things. But it's sad now, 40 years old, still living life for nothing. And someday they're going to wake up at 70 years old and go, where did my life go? There was nothing fulfilling about it. I spent my whole life for myself. There was nothing fulfilling in my life. I had kids, I had a family, but there was something missing. Because listen, the only thing that is fulfilling, the only thing that lasts is what we do for the Lord. So please, please, this is always a reminder to me. And whenever I get either emotional or whenever I get to speak about it, the reason I can be like this is because I'm speaking to myself. Please, you guys, don't waste this little amount of life on yourself, because you have eternity to spend with the Lord that is going to be far greater to just worship his name. But while you're here, give God the glory he so rightfully deserves. Any problem in your life, give God glory. Any victory in your life, give God glory. Any struggle, any hurt, any weakness, give God the glory and watch what he'll do with it. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for tonight. Lord, we thank you for how beautiful you are, and Lord, that we can come here at this new year, Lord, and strive, Lord, to have the best 2017 in our walk, Lord. And if we can say, Lord, that it wasn't the best year of our walk with you, Lord, there is a problem with our walk with you. Every year should be the best year of our walk with you. Lord, if we're not moving forward, we're moving backwards. So Lord Jesus, I just pray for every one of us, Lord, as we start off this new year, Lord, that we would all have the focus, Lord, that we would have an eternal perspective and what you're wanting to do in our life. Lord, I pray we'd be these willing vessels, Lord, that we wouldn't look to you as being these vessels and question you. Lord, that we wouldn't question on why you do things in our life, that we wouldn't question on why you made us a certain way or these things. Instead, we would just thank you Lord, that our heart this year in 2017 would just be a grateful heart. Lord, that there'd be thanksgiving, Lord. Lord, every person in this room, Lord, can have a peace tonight. Every person in this room can have a joy tonight if they remember that their trials, that their problems are all temporary. They're but for a moment, but your kingdom is forever. Let us all remember that, Lord God. Let our weakness just disappear, Lord, in the strength, Lord, of you. So, Lord Jesus, keep us this week. Lord, let us apply these things to our lives and let us wake up tomorrow feeling completely renewed, completely refreshed, and completely ready to do whatever you have for us. Lord Jesus, thank you. In Jesus' name we all said, amen.
Thanks again for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed this week's message. If you would like to contact us, you can contact us at www.joshuasprings.org or you can give us a call at 760-365-0769. Hope to see you next week, and God bless you.